Good morning. You may be seated. Welcome to New Hope Church. Great to have you with us today, and it is great to be with you today. All right? It's a joy to be home again. All those who got home last night around 6 o'clock from Africa, would you rise? All right? Would you rise? Look at this. Look at this. All right. There's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 of us, all right, who are here in the 9:15 after traveling over 30-some hours to get home, all right? We left Abidjan on Friday night, their time, at 11 p.m., and we arrived, and they're 8 hours ahead of us, all right? And that doesn't count the day before, the 16-hour bus ride from the village of Doropo to the city of Abidjan. 16 and a half hours. Okay. That's coming from the gal who got to ride in an air-conditioned bus, all right, both directions, all right? They got spoiled this year, guys. Air-conditioned bus, all right, which we've never had before. So that was really nice. That was really, really nice. But it was a long, we made a record going. Less than 12 hours getting there. It's never happened before. So that was awesome. But it was a great ride. All of our team were troopers. Here's the good news. Here's the great news. 10 of us left here. And the good news is 9 of us returned. That's 90%. I think that's pretty good. All right. The one who did not return with us is Ecosia. Her dad went to visit relatives in Ghana, which is just next door to us, all right, from where we were. So she left from Abidjan and went to Ghana to visit family and did not come home with us. She will come home at the end of this coming week. So thank you for all your prayers, your support, your texts of encouragement while we were gone. We appreciate all of that so very much. Big thanks to the staff here for all the extra work they did while we were gone. Thanks to Mark and Corey for their messages. While I was gone, I got emails of encouragement that both of them did a good job. So we are grateful for that. I understand they probably did a better job preaching than you all did attending. But anyway, that's a message for another day. All right. But anyway, great. Glad you're here today. Let me highlight a few announcements. I'm just getting caught up with things, so if I miss a few, forgive me, but we're going to hit some of them here real quick. Today is Widow's Lunch Bunch at 12:30. Ladies, if you've had a loss in your life, would like to meet with other ladies who've experienced a very similar thing and recovered and or are in recovery through that process, they meet once a month for lunch, and all the information of where they're meeting today is right here in your bulletin. They would love to have you come join them. If you have received Christ in recent months or year and you've not been baptized but would like to be, you're new to the New Hope Fellowship, you may have been a Christian a while but never been baptized and would like to be, take one of the communication cards in the pew in front of you, put your name and contact information on it, check baptism. We will follow up with you, and we're going to set a date very, very soon for when we can take care of those. Those cards are also there for our guests today. If you were visiting, you've never been here before, or you've been but never filled out a card, we'd love to know that you are with us. Please take it out, fill it out, drop it in the offering when it comes by. We make a promise. We will not beat on your door or annoy you on the phone, but through the mail, we're going to put information that will answer a lot of questions you have about our fellowship and maybe ways in which you are looking to be engaged. We will answer those questions. Grief Share is going to be starting up this week. They're going to have two different time periods. One's on Tuesday night. I believe the other one is on Tuesday mornings. The other is on Wednesday evenings. Am I getting that right? Yes. Okay, you can sign up for either one as the sign-ups come around. If you've had a loss in your life and would like some support and encouragement and scriptural direction, this is a wonderful group to be a part of. Literally hundreds in our church and our community have taken advantage of it over the years, and this is a great way to bring you to a place of recovery. Also on the sign-up sheets is not only sign up for Grief Share, but also for Financial Peace University. It's a, Mark, is this one 7 or 8 weeks? 9 weeks, all right. 7, 8, 9. I almost got there. It's a 9-week study on finances, what's good, sound financial practices, and biblically based practices for handling your personal and family finances. And if you would like to be a part of that, please sign up, and future information will come your way. And then last but not least on the sign-up clipboard is if you like to ride a motorcycle, And you would like to go on a day trip with a lot of folks from the church. It's coming up on April the 22nd. They're going to ride over to Phil's Fish Market at Moss Landing for a meal. And so it's a great trip. This time of year, man, the scenery is beautiful. And so if you'd like to go, please sign up so they can make adequate preparations. So those are the three things on the sign-up sheet. Starting this afternoon at 12:30, our high school kids are going to do a 30-hour famine. They are going to go without food for 30 hours, all right, to sort of identify with what starving children go through in other countries. We have come from an area where food often is scarce and physical resources are minimal at best and more frequently absent. When you see children with bloated bellies, there's two reasons for that. One, a lack of good food, and number two, worms. And it causes the joints to swell and the abdomen to enlarge, and it's real challenges. And our kids are going to attempt to identify and then raise money to fight hunger. So we're glad that they are going through that identification process. Next Sunday afternoon at 12:15, right here in the sanctuary, we'll have a church-wide business meeting. It's to do a couple things. One, we will give you the final 2016 financial report of last year. We've given you a general one, but we'll be specific in this one. And it finalizes 2016. Number two, we'll bring you up to date on the ongoing forever fiasco adventure of a building project. And we may have some important decisions to make, so we'd love to have you here to hear that. And then third, we have a few elder board recommendations to share with you for the coming year as well. So that will be next Sunday afternoon at 12:15. Women's Spring event, you have sign-ups in the pavilion afterwards, all right? Information about it here. You're going to build this beautiful summertime terrarium, all right? And it's really cool. And I understand to do this other places would cost you a lot of money to do it. So, ladies, just have a whale of a time at that event and sign up right out there, okay? And that's coming up very, very quickly. Next Saturday, in fact. Celebrate Recovery, March 2nd. Eric, stand up just so folks know who you are. They may not. That's Eric Olson. He's the director of our Celebrate Recovery. Well, you know, Celebrate Recovery even found its way all the way to Ivory Coast, Africa. We met a lady from Oklahoma who was there and what was her drug of choice? Meth. For years, nearly destroyed her life. And as a result of programs like Celebrate Recovery, her life's back on track. She loves the Lord. She wanted to go to Ivory Coast, Africa. And so she was there with us this week. So they are going to be celebrating their 8-year anniversary as a ministry of New Hope. And that's on Thursday, March the 2nd. It will be right here in the service. Dinner will be at 5:30, and then the program in here at 6:30. And there's always wonderful if you don't know what Celebrate Recovery is all about, this is a great night to come. And you will hear testimonies of life-transforming things that have occurred in men and women and young people's lives. And so two worship groups that night. All right. Hour and 15 minutes. All right, be a great evening. Come check it out. We always love to be there for that event. A couple of prayer requests. Phil Panos, precious Phil around here, who you normally see moving and circulating as one of our head ushers. He's been in the hospital this week. I understand he had a UTI infection. He's home now. He's running around his house. Hopefully by next week he'll be back, but continue to pray for his recovery. Paulie Good from our church, who's battled cancer for several years now, is under hospice care. And so please be remembering to pray for Paulie and for her family. Cecil and Kay Spurlock, I saw that one. I didn't know what it was about, but I saw Cecil today. Kay's sister, it's got rapidly declining dementia and Alzheimer's. And she lived in a home all alone. And so now she is with Cecil and Kay. They are trying to make arrangements for what her next step care is going to be. But in the meantime, she is living with them. So please be praying for them. And one handed to me in the 8 o'clock service from Wanda Wood. Her son-in-law has esophageal cancer surgery this coming Tuesday at UCSF. And he's got lots of other health conditions that make this a challenging surgery. So those are just a few of the updates that we wanted to share with you. During the morning message today, I'm going to give you a few updates, all right, and some things about the trip. Just kind of intertwine it into the sermon today. And then we are going to schedule early this week a date before we get to the mid part of March, that we'll have a Sunday evening event here, and we'll give a chance for all the team to be able to share their thoughts, their perspectives. You'll be able to see pictures from each of them that they took in the areas that they worked in, and we'll have an evening, probably have dessert, all right, and just enjoy a wonderful time together. All right, so I'm going to ask our ushers to come forward, wait on us as we have our morning tithes and offering. Gentlemen, would you come? Would you please join with me as we pray? Father, thank you for the life that you share with us, and that you share that life with us, whether we are in Clovis, California, or Doropo, Ivory Coast, Africa. You are a God that is not bound by space. You are not bound by time. You are not bound by location. And so, Father, thank you that wherever we are as your children, you are with us. That's why the scripture is filled with occasions to where you say, do not be afraid. I am with you always, even to the end of the world. Thank you, Father, that we can bank on that promise every moment of every day of our life. Thank you for your provisions in all of our lives over these last few weeks, but particularly we give you great thanks, filled with deep gratitude today from the team of 10 from New Hope, who you use to fulfill your great commission through this community of believers. Thank you that they all have returned. Thank you that they are all upright and healthy and doing well, and we're grateful for that. But thank you most of all for what you taught us in our journey together. For what you want to teach us today, may the ears of our hearts be open, and may our understanding be clear of your message for each of us. Just as you whispered to Elijah in a still small voice in a cave on top of a mountain, just as you spoke to the crowd that assembled at the baptism of your son, the Lord Jesus, whether it is in a loud, audible voice or a quiet, still voice to our hearts, may we have ears to hear what you have to say to us today. As a result of our time together, we can say it was good to have been in the house of the Lord. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. We're going to open with a little quick visual report about the trip. This was done by 1040i. It was published on their last Facebook kind of testimony at the end of the trip. It gives you just some basic facts of the things that happened while we were there. It's just a couple of minutes long. We're then going to kind of wrap up these 2 weeks with a brief sermon on the Great Commission. Kind of seen it in action, actually, by 10 members of your congregation. And then we're going to wrap up with another short little video of pictures that I pulled off of my iPhone, all right, that just hit a few key things that I'll briefly talk about today. And we'll kind of wrap things up then, all right, for this. And we are going to have an evening where the entire team gets to share. They've got much better pictures than I do. But I know some of you had a lot of questions, and so hopefully we can answer a lot of that, and it kind of puts a nice bow on what this part of our year has already been. I'm standing here, some of you are saying, Tim, that's not your regular Bible. No, it isn't. And there's a couple of reasons why I don't have my regular Bible today. One of them is because I'm confused. I'm off a week, okay? I thought somehow this was the last Sunday of the month. And it's not the last Sunday of the month, and I pulled it out for a little nostalgia's sake. I preached my very first sermon out of this Bible, which will be 47 years ago next Sunday. Okay, next Sunday. So for nostalgia, I pulled it out, but I really pulled it out 1 week early, all right? So that was confusion. The second reason, which might be the first reason, is because my main preachy Bible is still in the suitcase in the backyard, and I haven't opened it yet since we got home. And so I needed a Bible today. By the way, that first sermon was 13 minutes long. I've never preached another 13-minute sermon in my entire life. But that's the way you start when you're 15, all right, and don't know very much. I had announced my call to preach on February the 8th in a Sunday night service at a church where I grew up, Dad's church. And Dad, as a pastor, didn't think that his son, now as a new preacher, should wait very long to preach his first sermon. So 2 weeks after I said God's called me to preach, I got to preach my first sermon out of the Red Bible. So anyway, if I could draw your attention towards the screen, this is the last video that was put on 1040i's Facebook with just some quick summaries. Outside temperature was between 108 and 115 most days. Inside the tent, it was about 88 degrees, and they were freezing. Okay, they're used to it being warmer. 108 to 115 was very good. No complaints. That's much better than the year we went, and it was 125. And every evening, till the last night, every evening we had to have blankets because it got cold. All right, in our tent. So it was a it was a good weather weather time for us. So overall, it was the smoothest trip out of the five trips I've ever been on. Your team from New Hope was absolutely awesome. They all just did great, and you'll hear more about that at the end and then in a couple of weeks. Turn to Matthew chapter 28, if you would, please. I'm going to be reading from there in a few minutes. Here's a few interesting quotes that I've come across over the last week or so in thinking about our activity and our engagement in the Great Commission of Matthew chapter 28. Here is a test to see if your mission on earth is finished. If you were alive, it isn't. So every one of you in the room, I'm here to tell you, your mission is not complete yet. Second quote. Every heart with Christ is a missionary, and every heart without Christ is a mission field. What a simple, singular statement if we could all grasp that. If you are a believer in Jesus Christ, you know that your eternal home is in heaven, and Christ's earthly home is your heart. Then you are a missionary. And every person you know who does not have that assurance of eternal life, whether they be your relative, your neighbor, your coworker, or the child in a far-flung part of the world like Ivory Coast, they are a mission field. I love this one. God has only one son. And he's a missionary. He left heaven to come to earth. You had 10 who left Clovis, Fresno, to go to Doropo, Ivory Coast. God's only son was a missionary. C.T. Studd, missionary from another generation, a professional athlete before he became a believer. C.T. Studd was a stud. And here's what he said. Some wish to live within the sound of a church or a chapel bell. I want to run a rescue shop within a yard of hell. Let me say that one again. Make sure you get it. Some wish to live within the sound of a church or a chapel bell. I want to run a rescue shop within a yard of hell. His approach was, I want every person to have a last chance, and I want to be there to share that chance with them. All of those quotes, I'm confident, have their basis out of what is known in the Scripture as the Great Commission. The Bible has the Great Command. The Bible has the Great Commandments. They're one and two. Out of the Great Command and out of the Great Commandments comes the Great Commission. I don't think you can separate those. The greatest command that's ever been given is to love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all your strength. That's the first great command. The second one Jesus said is very similar to it. He said, with these two commands, you can hang every other biblical rule, law, principle, whatever you want to call it. You can hang everything on these two. It originates, love God with every part of your being. And if you love him with every part of your being, you cannot help but keep the second command. And the second command is this: love your neighbor as yourself. If you'll recall, there were some who asked Jesus when he made that statement, who's my neighbor? Remember that? If you don't, go look it up. It's in Matthew's gospel. It's in John's gospel. They were the Pharisees and the Sadducees. They were the religious teachers and leaders of the community who should have embraced Jesus with all their heart, with all their soul, with all their mind, with all their strength. But they hadn't. In fact, they were trying to trip him up and find an excuse to get rid of him, to try to embarrass him publicly so that his popularity would diminish. And Jesus, I think it was pretty clear. It obviously wasn't very clear to them. If you have to ask who your neighbor is, you've already failed the first commandment. See, if you love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all your strength, you will not question who your neighbor is. You're going to know who that is. And he said, once you know me and love me the way you should love me, you're going to love the world. So out of the foundation of the great commandments, we have let's read from verse 16, Matthew's gospel. If mine reads slightly different than yours, I'm not reading out of my NIV version today. I'm reading out of the Bible I grew up with, which is not better or worse than the one I read from now. It's just different. Meaning's the same. Some of the words are different. This is King James. I was waiting for my dad to say amen. That was... he couldn't hear me. All right. I'm reading out of King James today, Dad. All right. Then the 11 disciples went into Galilee. And they went into a mountain where Jesus had appointed them. Jesus made an appointment with the disciples. And he said, you're to meet me at this place, a mountain in Galilee. And when they saw him, they worshiped him, but some doubted. And Jesus came, and he spake unto them. He spoke to them, and he said, all power. That word, NIV, all authority. Use them both if you want. All power and authority is given unto me in heaven and on earth. Those Pharisees and Sadducees who would ask Jesus what the greatest commands were and who would ask Jesus, who's my neighbor? Also in Matthew's Gospel, chapter 10 or 11, they said, by what authority do you say and do the things that you say and do? Jesus is making it very clear, by all authority. There's no exceptions anywhere. I have it all. Because of the finished work that I have done. I lived, I died, I was buried, I rose again. There's not an authority left that I have not defeated. By all authority given unto me, I'm going to tell you what I'm going to tell you. And what does he tell us? Go. Go ye therefore, because I have all authority. Verse 19. Go, teach all nations, baptize them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whatever I have commanded you, and I will be with you always, even to the end of the world. I will be with you always, at all times, in everywhere, and in every place. Jesus' band of disciples at this passage in the scripture, at this time and place in history, now numbered 11, not 12. The demise of Judas reduced the numbers from a dozen to 11. Oh, if Judas could have waited one more night before he hung himself. If Judas could have just survived one dark night of his soul, things could have been so very different for him. Don't ever make life-altering decisions in the darkness of the night. Always wait till the brightness of the day comes. Resurrection morning could have made such a big difference in Judas's life if he had just been patient. These 11 were obedient to an appointment that Jesus asked them to keep. And it's this place in Galilee where it all began. If you go back to Matthew chapter 4, you don't have to turn there, but I'll turn and read it to you. But in Matthew chapter 4, verse 12 through 15, now when Jesus had heard that John was cast into prison, Jesus went to Galilee. He left Nazareth, and he came and he dwelt in Capernaum, where it's by the seacoast and the borders of Zebulun and Naphtali, that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken by Isaiah the prophet, that this is where Jesus will start. And notice in it, beyond Jordan, at the Galilee of the Gentiles. This is where the public ministry of Jesus got started. And this is where Jesus would give his final message before he ascended. He began and ended at the very same place, the mountain in Galilee. Jesus and his disciples, up until this moment in time, had primarily concentrated on one mission. That one mission is outlined for us in Matthew chapter 10, verse 6, where Jesus tells his disciples to go seek out the lost sheep of the house of Israel. Jesus came, he was born to the nation of Israel. His lineage can be traced all the way back to Abraham, then through David, and all the way finally to his birth. Jesus said, I have come to my own. I've come to bring the message to Israel, but not to Israel alone, but because they have been my chosen people, I will come to them first, and hopefully through them, the world will know. But Jesus said, I've come to my own, and my own would not listen to me. But up until this time, that had been the primary commission of the disciples through Jesus. Seek the lost sheep of the house of Israel. But now in Matthew 28, the time had come for a full-blown worldwide mission. The mountain imagery is a familiar story throughout the scriptures. God did a lot of things at mountaintop moments. How many of you, if you've been a Christian very while, you've ever had a mountaintop experience? If you don't know what I mean by that, then you probably haven't. If you have, how many of you have had a mountaintop experience with God? Yeah, it usually started at church camp. As a teenager, man, you got away from the regular routine of life. You got up there, man, God got a hold of you hard. Woo! It was good. We got men's retreats or women's retreats, usually at those moments that we get away and we leave everything down below, and all of a sudden our focus, our attention. I would say if I asked the team here today, there was some mountaintop moment for them on this mission trip. Usually there is something when we restrict our vision, when the regular routines of life are no longer drawing our attention and we become singular of focus and purpose. It's amazing what God shares with us and teaches us. And we have these moments where it's an aha moment. Ah, I've never understood that before. And the Bible is filled with these aha mountaintop moments and experiences. If we were to take the time, we could go back to Exodus chapter 20. Many of you, if you've been in church very long, what do you remember took place in Exodus chapter 20? What was that? Ten Commandments. Exactly correct. Where did Moses receive the Ten Commandments? Top of Mount Sinai. Okay? He met God on top of the mountain. God with his finger carved out the Ten Commandments on tablets of stone. While Moses is having a mountaintop experience, the children of Israel are ending up in the valley of despair. They could not wait like Judas could not wait. They could not wait for Moses to return with his message of how he was going to care for them in their wilderness wanderings and take them to the promised land. They could not wait, so they took matters into their own hands. Judas could not wait, so he took matters into his own hands. If you are in a valley of despair, my message to you today is this: wait. Wait. Don't rush. Wait. Wait for God to call you to the mountain, because he will. God wants to share with you his plans and purpose for your life, but often he needs to get rid of the clutter and the distraction of our life, and he'll call us somewhere. Sometimes it's a physical ailment that puts us down. We can't keep going. I had one of those brief moments in Africa. I woke up to go help cook breakfast one morning, and I staggered like a drunken sailor. I could not get my balance. I could not get my bearings. God had some lessons to teach me at that moment. My body was tired. I don't like to admit that I can't. As most of you know, I'm not the tallest person in the world. As a kid, that challenged me. So I might not be able to outmuscle anybody else, but I wasn't going to let them outwork me. God said, okay, I've given you a pain in the knee and you haven't slowed down. I've put gout back in your foot and you haven't slowed down. See how you can do when you can't walk straight. And what I had to learn Because you see, you sit in a room, you didn't travel thousands and thousands of miles to sit in a sick room. Unless God has something to teach you. And after a few hours of grousing in my head and sleeping a lot, actually, in one of my brief moments to wake up, I thought, God, you're dealing with my pride, aren't you? I would rather be out there where people see me running and say, Tim, you shouldn't run so much. No, I'm okay, I'm fine. Okay, God, I'm not fine. Okay, I understand. But you see, we had to wait to find that out. God puts us in places where we slow down so we can hear his voice. Exodus 20, he gives the Ten Commandments. In Matthew chapter 5, 6, and 7, Jesus is speaking from a mountaintop. And what does he share? Remember the message? It's called the Sermon on the Mount. And in there, the opening lines are, blessed are the meek of the earth, for they shall inherit the kingdom of God. In Exodus 20, we get 10 commandments. In Matthew chapter 5, we get 9 beatitudes, and they come from the mountain. 1 Kings chapter 19, and forgive me if you're new to church, you don't know all these stories, I'll give you the addresses and you can check them out and let me just summarize. But in 1 Kings chapter 19, it's right after Elijah had a great victory, where? On a mountain. It's called Mount Carmel. Elijah by himself confronts the entire nation of Israel and King Ahab and Jezebel, and he takes to task in a spiritual warfare 850 prophets of Baal and Asheroth, the handmade gods that the people of Israel had chosen to worship instead of the God who rescued them from slavery. And Elijah takes them on and he wins. It's the Super Bowl. And he wins. By the way, congratulations, Patriots, in our absence from the country. I just made half of you happy and half of you very angry at me, but I really didn't care who won. But Elijah wins. And he comes down the mountain, and guess who's waiting at the bottom of the mountain? And after every mountaintop experience, there will always be something that the evil one sends our way to try to destroy what was accomplished on the mountaintop. And Elijah let Satan win. After he allowed God to bring him victory, when he gets to the valley floor, he allows Satan to win. Do you remember who opposed him? Jezebel, the wife of King Ahab. She was angry because Elijah had whipped all of her prophets. She says, I'm going to kill you. One woman, terrified, Elijah. What 850 false prophets couldn't do, one strong-willed woman did. Terrified him. And he runs off to the desert and he parks himself under a little bitty tree and he says, God, just kill me. Just take my life. Don't make decisions in the dark valleys. Elijah sat under the tree and let God feed him and give him rest. And after 3 days of that, where did God send Elijah? You ought to know by now. To a top of a mountain. And he went into the cave. And a storm came, and Elijah thought, oh, God's going to talk to me now in a storm. And God didn't speak to him. It was in a quiet, still, small voice, the scripture says. God's spirit speaking to the spirit of Elijah. Elijah heard him say this, I'm not finished with you yet. I want you to leave this mountain. You're going to go anoint a new king of Israel because Ahab is finished. Jezebel, she's about to become dog food. Literally. If you don't know the story, go read it. Literally. I want you to come down this mountain. Those who intimidated you cannot intimidate me. I've got a new king. Here's his name. Go anoint him. Elijah, I think my work with you is not far from being over. I've got a young man to take your place. His name's Elisha. Take the cloak that you've worn around your shoulders that was my gift to you as a symbol of my power and presence with you, and I want you to put it on his shoulders. I'm commissioning you to go anoint a new king and pass the blessing of being a prophet to Elisha. And when that's done, I'll take you home. And oh baby, if you've never read The Homecoming of Elijah, you need to go read that in 1 Kings. He's one of only two men who did not see death in this life. He was snatched up in a chariot of fire, and they've written songs about it for millenniums now. Just as God commissioned Elijah to go anoint a king and a new prophet, Jesus commissions 11 disciples to go turn the world upside down. And here's what I want you to notice. Here's what I want you to get more than anything else. Elijah had just been troubled by doubt and fear. It did not make him worthless to God. It made him usable for God. Did you catch the verse? 17, and when they saw him, they worshiped him, but some doubted. These are the 11. There's nobody else there. These are the 11. This is James and John and Peter and Andrew and Matthew and Bartholomew. And the others, I've forgotten their names at the moment. But it's the 11. They heard Jesus for 3 years of ministry. They witnessed his crucifixion, most of them from a long ways off because they were terrified. For 3 days, they hid in their bedrooms, terrified for their own life. Jesus shows up by walking through walls and appears to them. He shows up on a coastline and he fixes them a fish breakfast, which sounds absolutely disgusting to me. But he fixed them a fish breakfast. And some still doubted. Did you come here this morning with some doubts? That does not nullify God's desire to still use you. Have you had moments where you just failed and screwed up? Your failures doesn't stop God from wanting to use you. He did it with Elijah. He did it with the 11 disciples. He'll do it with us as well. Notice Jesus approached them and he spoke to them. Jesus has been approaching mankind ever since the fall. And especially through the incarnation, him becoming a man. And Jesus is not about to stop now. The first move has always been Jesus looking for you. And when he finds you, he then wants you to look for him. Major Thomas used to quote a verse over and over and over again in his times in this pulpit and this podium. And Major Thomas would say, the Lord Jesus, God himself, is looking for any man, woman, boy, or girl who in honest interest will find God. God is looking for you. And Jesus said, I speak with all authority. And this authority says, go. Go. The going is most important. Isaiah 52:7 says this. How beautiful upon the mountains are the feet of him or her that brings good tidings, that shares peace, that brings good tidings of good news, that publishes salvation. And that same verse is quoted again in Romans chapter 10, verse 15. Blessed are the feet of those who preach the gospel. Feet, I think, are maybe the ugliest part of the human body, and yet God says they are beautiful. The lead pastor in all the Ivory Coast, Pastor Paul. And my first trip there, about halfway through our stay in Doropo, he came to me one night and he said, Pastor Tim, I would like for you to talk to my cousin about Jesus Christ. I'm thinking, you're his cousin, you're his pastor, why don't you talk to him? I didn't actually think it, I said it. And he said, we're like brothers, we're too close. Oh, I've planted, Tim, I've planted lots of seeds, but I think God has brought you here to either water or harvest. Would you talk to my cousin? I said, okay, Pastor Paul, but you know, I don't speak French. He said, it's okay. He got educated at a university in the States. He speaks English. I said, great, set the appointment up. It wasn't on a mountaintop, but it was under a tree. And he and I met, we visited for about 2 hours. I just answered his questions as best I could from the scripture. After about 2 hours, he just sat silent. I had nothing else to say. And we sat there for a few minutes. Finally, to break the silence, I looked at him and I said, is there any reason that at this moment under this tree, is there any reason you can think of why you cannot invite Jesus Christ in your life, have the assurance that your sins are forgiven, have the hope that one day when you die, you're going to go to heaven, and between now and then, let your heart be the home that cradles the life of Christ. And he sat there and thought for a matter of minutes, and finally looked over at me and he said, I can think of no reason. And right there under that tree, with his own words, didn't need me to prompt him or anything, he prayed a most beautiful prayer and invited Christ in his life. Over the last 4 years, I've seen Pastor Paul every year, and I've asked him, how's your cousin doing? Oh, he's doing good. Oh, he's doing good, Tim. But I had not seen him till our last day. We stopped in Tonda, which is where a school is that's been built there. And while I was there, here comes this man with this big smile on his face, and he walks up, and he puts his arms around me, and he hugs me. And I said, oh, did your cousin tell you I asked about you already? Yes, yes. How are you doing in your faith? He said, Tim, Sister Tim, I'm growing. I said, are you using the Bible? Oh, he said, Tim, I read it every day, morning and evening. I said, how about? He said, Tim, I've read that book you've given me 7 or 8 times already. I said, you're growing. I'm growing. See, it's preaching and it's baptizing and it's teaching. That's what Jesus told the disciples to do. There's a story that's told of a little child in an African village who wandered off in the tall jungle grass and she could not be found. Most of the tribe searched all day long and they could not find her. And darkness and the cold of the night drove them back to their village fires. The next day, the tribal members formed a big circle on the outskirts of their village. And they held hands as best they could. And in holding hands, they searched and searched. And they found the little girl. Due to the extreme cold of the night, she had not survived. In her anguish and through her tears, the mother cried out, if only we would have held hands sooner. If only we would have held hands sooner. Over the past 2 weeks, you had 10 representatives from New Hope who not only held each other's hands, but we held the hands of others from Oklahoma and Alaska and West Virginia and Georgia and Washington and all over the Ivory Coast. And we held hands together in a place called Doropo. And we found some children and some men and women who needed God. You see, it's not enough, folks, that we all share a common goal. We must all work together to accomplish it without hesitation. I'm going to take about 5 extra minutes, okay? That'll be 5 minutes less than I normally take from you. Let me tell you what happened several times during this trip is members of other congregations who were there, particularly after the finished work of the library, and they got to go to the dedication service of the new library. Probably had 5 or 6 different people from different congregations come to me and say, I wished our church could do what your church has done. I wished our church had as much interest in missions as your church does. You all are wonderful. You are a wonderful group of people to allow your pastor and your board to give such emphasis to mission giving. When I tell pastors we gave 27% of what we received last year away, most of them say we couldn't survive by doing that. And my answer to them is, if you don't learn to get there, you probably won't survive. It's more important that we give and address the needs around the world than it is that we build a new building and go into deep debt to do it. And so thank you for being the kind of people who give your leadership in your church as well as the members of your congregation the thumbs up to fulfill the Great Commission. The Great Commission is to go across the street, to go across town, to go across this nation, and to go around the world. And you all give us great freedom and generosity to make that happen. So I thank you for being a great commissioned church. You're going to hear from this team in the next few weeks. And on April 1st and 2nd, we have a chance to fulfill the Great Commission again within the context of our community through the Luis Palau Fresno City Fest. And we'll talk more about that in the days ahead. When I asked members of the team, sometimes this was an impossible task to do, and that's okay. It is hard to put 2 weeks into one word. But for today, I wanted one word. Here are some one-word answers that the team gave me that these 2 weeks meant to them. One person's response was blessing. This was a huge, huge blessing. Another one said, I'll never forget the smiles. The Ivorian people smile all the time until you get ready to take their picture. Then they don't smile. It's quite the opposite of Americans. We smile all the time. That's called a mask. I mean, we don't smile all the time until we're told to take a picture, and then we smile. That's a mask for what we're thinking. Another one said opportunities. Had opportunities like I never would have had before. Another one said rewarding, most rewarding time I've ever spent in my life. Another one said perspective. I see life differently than I ever have before. One other word, it was Kathy, who the first day there and the first day we're there, it's maybe one of the hardest working days we have because everything has to get set up and prepared for all the ministries to take place, from the medical surgical rooms to the kids' fest preparations to the constructions, getting things laid out. At the end of that day, as Kathy and I crossed paths from our tent to the dining area, I said, Kathy, how was your day? She said, ask me tomorrow. And when tomorrow came and we crossed paths about the same time of day, before I could ask her how her day was, she said, Tim, ask me how my day was. I said, Kathy, how was your day? She said, amazing. Do you know what the difference was from one day to the next? That day, her life crossed paths with 170 children at Kids Fest. Ministry took place. And it was amazing. We're gonna dim the lights. There's a little video. This is rough. These are just pictures off my iPhone. I threw together actually around 6 this morning, and it's about as short as the other video you saw. And I want to show it to you, and then we may go back through it. I'll hit just a couple of highlights with it before I cut you loose today. While they're getting everything ready for that, let me tell you, next Sunday we're gonna start a new sermon series called Enemies of the Heart. Dealing with the emotions that try to control us. I'm not going to tell you what those four emotions are. I'll let you try to figure it out between now and next Sunday. But next Sunday, I'll let you in on the secret of what four emotions try to control and eventually destroy us. So, if we're ready, take off. No, they surprised us with that sign. They had made that sign a few days before, and the area of the Neonan village where Madame Elise lives with those 56 children from elementary age through junior high that she provides care for, that section of their village is now called New Hope Village. Those three buildings that we have built and all the stuff that's in that library, you all are responsible for making happen. $27,000 for that library. That's to pour the foundation, build the walls, put the roof on it. People from our church were part of that construction project to furnish it with 24, 23 iPads, solar electricity, because there's no electricity out there, solar panels on the roof. The solar panel comes in to two gigantic batteries that stores the electricity, which then goes through a converter. And this is what amazed me, folks, all right? That converter then takes feeds into the safe. We shipped a safe over, so at the end of every day, those iPads can be stored, all right, and can be powered up again. They can bring all 23 of those iPads back to full power at one time in 4 hours because of the conversion process that they figured out and installed there. And so you saw it looks primitive to us. It is the most advanced thing, even if you go to the big cities called Abidjan. For education, that is the most advanced building in the nation. Okay? It's pretty impressive, guys. You all are responsible for it. I always forget how to pronounce his name. The Sloans sponsor him. Jaredani. Jaredani, his picture was up there twice. Jaredani, last year on the nationwide education test that they are required to take, he scored the highest score of any child ever in the history of the Ivory Coast. On that exam, taught right there in New Hope Village by Madame Elise and her staff of teachers. They take after the Sloans. He takes after the Sloans in his brilliance. I told him that in the 8 o'clock service. Now, they only picked him because his picture was on a board. Just so happens to be. They sent him a letter. It had a little money that had been converted to Ivorian Cephas. And when Madame Elise gave it to him, he just sat there. I was on the other end of the bench. Shelley was on the other side of him. He just sat there. He didn't say a word. Madame Elise started to scold him. You should be saying thank you. His eyes kind of filled with a bit of fear. And he looked at Madame Elise and he says, I have no way of knowing how to thank anybody for a gift such as this. Could you help me thank them? And so together they thank the Sloans through us for that opportunity. The little boy Chris, I called his name out. He and Shelly were face to face for a moment. He kind of adopted Shelly 2 years ago. He's in fourth grade now. 2 years back when he was just in second grade, he's the other interpreter for me at Kids Fest Message. It goes from English to French, from French to Lobi. He's the one who translated from French to Lobi. And let me tell you, when he translated with the same emotion, the same inflection, the same hand movements as I used. As a second grader, okay? As a second grader. I understand he speaks four languages, all right? French, Lobi, and two other tribal dialects there. Madame Lee shared with us that out of all of her children, this is one that she wants to send to the school in Tanda. In Tanda, it is a English-French school, and it's high-tech as well, all right? But the key to it is they teach English. And she said, I want him to go to the school in Tanda. And we, Shelley, inquired, how many other students do you have that you would like to send there? And she said, no others. Just him. And we said, why Chris? And she said, because I know that with English, if I were to die tomorrow, one, Chris will be just fine if he knows English. And my work here will carry on if he knows English. She said, we wanted to send him this year, but we did not have the funds. I'm a soft touch. I look over at Shelly. She looks at me. We sort of nod. I said, Madame Elise, what would it cost? And she said, I don't know. Mike Cousineau just happened to walk by
about that moment. I said, Mike, what does it cost to send a student a year to Tonda from here? He began, He said, Tim, in American dollars, probably about $950. That's his clothes, that's his shots, that's his eating, his food that they have to pay for at the school, and the cost of tuition there, about $1,000. I said, is there room for Chris? He said, yes. I said, sign him up. Shelley and I looked at Madame Elise and said, we've just adopted Chris. He's our new Ivorian child, and he's going to Tonda next year. You cannot help but be touched. What's Mike's favorite line? Not that one. No, about you can't. What the heart cannot taste. What the eyes have not seen.
Once you've tasted, you cannot taste what you've seen.
That's close. I'll get it. I'll get it before we meet again. But it's a great line. But once you've seen, you cannot forget. You cannot ignore. So thank you for being a church that makes it. Yes? Please tell them. Madame Elise, at the commissioning of the library, again, her eyes filled with tears, and she's got such a big, beautiful smile. Madame Elise said, when New Hope built the first dormitory, my heart was happy. And when New Hope came back and you built the second dormitory, my heart was really, really happy. And now that you've come back and you've built the library, the only way you could know how I feel is if you could get inside of me and feel what I feel. I have no words. Thank you. These children have a chance, because New Hope came, New Hope gave, New Hope cares. She has, I'll point her out when we meet together, that she has a new junior high student that she didn't have. One of you are going to get her as your sponsor, because they've lost a couple, and so there's a few more that she's taken. This one girl, junior high age, she lived close to the border of Burkina Faso, which is the country just to the north. To walk to the junior high in Doropo, she had to get up at 4 a.m. every morning to walk to school. School did not end until 7 in the evening, and then she would walk back home in the dark at night alone. And Madame Elise found her walking and asked her why. She said, I need education. There's nothing up there. I heard about here. I don't want my parents just to sell me. So Madame Elise went to her parents, got permission, and this young lady now lives at New Hope Village in the Onan and gets to go to school. So you make that possible. God bless you. Have a great day. Get out of here. Keep fulfilling the Great Commission. Go, and go now.